Hello and welcome back to Sam's Disney Diary, episode number 94, the D23 Expo 2017 Legends of Imagineering. Be sure to watch the full video at samsdisneydiary.com and don't forget YouTube, Twitter, Instagram, and the podcast, and the Disney Nerds podcast. Make sure you check it out. 2017 marks the 30th anniversary of the Disney Legends Award. And while the opening of the D23 Expo featured the Legends Ceremony honoring the newest Disney legends from film, movie, television, theater, animation, publishing, and voice personalities, the names you instantly recognize in 2017, Mark Hamill, Carrie Fisher, Oprah Winfrey, among others. I'm partial to the Imagineers, the people behind the Disney parks, the people that found a way to get it done. The final panel of the D23 Expo featured the latest Imagineering legend, Wayne Jackson. One of his many accomplishments, moving It's a Small World from New York World's Fair to Disneyland. But the panel was really a history lesson. The panel was led by John Stamos. Yes, the John Stamos who has the D from Disneyland in his backyard. He might have been on television too, I'm not sure. Along with Tony Baxter and Marty Sklar. The majority of the panel was a walk down memory lane with Marty and Tony reminiscing about their personal accounts with iconic Imagineering legends, personal accounts of working with Walt, John Hench, Herb Ryman, Ken Anderson, Mary Blair, ex Atencio. The list goes on and includes personal stories outside of the parks. Just a fascinating hour of storytelling from some of the best storytellers in the business. Now, at the time of this recording, there was no way of knowing that this would be Marty Sklar's last public appearance as a Disney Imagineering ambassador, a role that he held since his retirement in 2009, retiring on July 17th, 2009, after 54 years of service, receiving a window on Disneyland's Main Street on, yes, July 17th. Yep, Disneyland's anniversary, the 54th anniversary. Starting as an editor of the Disneyland newspaper 1 month before the park opened, Marty was the only Disney employee to be at all of the Disney parks openings around the world. Marty, thank you. Thank you for the kind words, the countless stories, the autograph inside my copy of One Little Spark, and I will always remember, without a story, you have nothing. Now, the panel opened with a short video montage of all of the Disney Imagineering legends. I hope you enjoy, and I'm so blessed to have had the opportunity to personally attend the Legends of Disney Imagineering at the D23 Expo 2017 and spend some time chatting with Marty, a conversation I will never forget. I hope you also enjoy, and Kongaloosh!
your host, actor, musician, and Disney Parks aficionado, Jon Stamos.
Disney geeks, I love you all. Welcome to the final panel of D23 Expo 2017, the legends of Walt Disney Imagineering. I can see you guys are really into it. You know, all the Imagineers. I am so excited to be here, honored. I grew up near here, 5 miles away. I spent most of my childhood here at Disneyland, most of my adulthood as well. I think I saw my first parade there. I went on my first date. I think I went through puberty there. But I did a lot of stuff at Disneyland. And I just, probably like you all here, it's just, you know, going through those gates, I would just forget, you know, real life or forget the outside world. Not that the outside world was terrible for me, but it was better once I was in Disneyland. And I think a lot of the values that I learned and the courage to go chase my dreams, part of who I am is because I spent so much time here. You know, I was thinking just a moment ago when I heard my voice, I was like, I'm on stage here moderating this panel at D23 with Tony Baxter and Marty Sklar. Like, if I could go back to the 14-year-old me standing in line at the Matterhorn right now, and I could see myself now, I was wearing a members only jacket. I used to wear my father's cologne, I wore Old Spice. Because I was, you know, trying to meet girls to go on the Matterhorn, because, you know, and you remember the Matterhorn, it was just one little seat to But I used to just go on with my best friend, Mike. But right now, if I could go back to that 14-year-old whispered ears, hey, John, it's going to be okay. One day you're going to be moderating this panel at D23. You won't have to stand in line as long, probably. You know that sign out on Harvard Boulevard that says, didn't that? It's gonna be in your backyard. Like, Jackson's gonna call you about it. And maybe, just maybe, you won't have to wear that cologne to meet chicks anymore. I still wear it, so. For us Disney fans, I know we regard Imagineers higher than, you know, actors and political figures. They're rock stars, really, aren't they? I mean, they're the rock stars of this theme here. And we have two of the biggest to talk to us about their stories, and also to talk about some of the past lectures that they have a connection to. So please give a rock star welcome to Marty Sklar and Tony Baxter. Symphony of creative people, as you call them, have carried on his tradition, and thanks to you guys and people like we get to still go to the park, and it just gets better and more beautiful every year. So thank you very much. Windows on the main streets and a lot of the parks, which is pretty cool. You both are Disney legends. You both have Disney Legend Awards. So my first question is, can I have them? Where are they? Let's start with you, Marty. Why'd you retire at such a young age, Marty?
My God.
No, I'm kidding.
54 years was enough.
That's it. I mean, Marty, to me, you're the keeper of the keys. Conscience here. I think he's the Jiminy Cricket of this organization, and you've been so marvelous. What you told me backstage that you first started, you wrote the Disney Gazette newspaper, right?
Well, they hired me. I was about to be the editor of the Daily Report at UCLA. And they were looking for, Walt was looking for somebody to put out a tabloid newspaper on Main Street in Disney to be sold for 10 cents. And somehow they found me a recommendation from somebody in the Alumni Association at UCLA, and Carl Walker, who later became the chairman of the company, was a Bruin, by the way. And Carl and I came into his office and, about 6 weeks before Disneyland opened, and I said, okay, we're going to hire you. And I started a month before Disneyland opened.
And you had a meeting with Walt about the newspaper, right?
Yeah, 2 weeks before the park opened, I had to present the concept to Walt Disney, and I was 21 years old.
Wow.
Had never worked professionally, and I was scared as hell.
That really illustrated how much you cared about every little detail.
It was amazing, John, because here it was total chaos in the park. It was the first time I ever done it, and Tony can tell you all these parks at the very end are just, you say, oh my God, are we ever going to get this done? And Disneyland, I'm telling you, when I walked out on Main Street for the first time a month before, I said, what the heck are they doing? When are they going to open? Next September?
Yeah.
No, July 17th. So it was interesting because when I look back on it, I look back on it later, I realized my career hadn't even begun. And it was almost over because if Walt didn't like what I presented, I was out the door and they'd get a pro to do it. But he did like it, and that's why my career in Disney lasted 54 years.
Thank God. Young Tony, you started as an ice cream scooper at the Carnation Plaza, right?
Yes, I did.
Tony and I, we had a great lunch. We got to Howard Green, got us together, we had a great lunch, and we got to see Walt's office there at the studios, and Burbank called me, said the Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs statue, the Oscar, it's gone. So I said, Tony, check my house. All right, so you got Big Thunder Mountain, which was Tony's. Indiana Jones. Splash Mountain. My favorite, Bigfoot.
Being a designer, it kind of gave me all these opportunities. So we were, building Big Thunder was kind of my first thing, and I went down there. I loved being a ride operator, just like, that's almost like being an actor, So I was, down there building the ride, and I said, what the heck, I'm going to put on the costume and do the thing.
There you go.
And then, lo and behold, they made me into a character, So the next thing I know, they were doing these comic books with a star in it. I thought I was going to be a star. It's not a villain. I'm a villain. Do I look like a bad person? I don't know. Maybe I am. So here's like what they thought I looked like. I don't think I look like that.
I don't look like that. Well,
and something to the that's a candid picture. So I guess the writing is on something like that. So then the next thing I thought, ventriloquism.
Right.
So we did a little thing, Journey in Imagination, for opening of Epcot. And I had this incredible character which we dearly love, Bigfoot, and I tried to give him a voice.
Yeah.
I wasn't very good at that. So they sent me halfway around the world to a blank field over in the outskirts of Paris.
Okay.
And said, make something out of it. And we'll go into that later, but in the next shot you'll see Marty and I on near the opening.
Is that you with the hat, Marty?
Oh, my hat.
Yeah, you still have it, don't you? And you had,
yeah, it's got 95 pins on it. But it weighs so much I can't even wear it anymore.
It's too big for luggage to take on the airline.
Did you guys learn to speak French?
The petit peu.
So no.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
It was that bad.
No.
So all right, then this guy comes in. You might know him, and he had done a few films, and they were doing this. We did this little thing called Star Tours, and I took advantage of that because there was another property he had. He made three movies at that time, and I knew there was an opening to do Indy, 3.5 Temple of the Forbidden Eye. And so I started. See, here's Karen and John. There I am working right again out there. And it was so good that they decided to make an action figure. So here I am.
You have a gun, you don't have a guitar.
No, I know.
Well, every cool action figure has a guitar.
You think?
Yeah.
Is that what would make it better? What do you folks think?
Did you see that? Did you see that photo of George Lucas without a beard?
Yeah.
He was dating Linda Ronstadt at the time, and she didn't like the beard. It was the only time in his life he cut it off. So that's a rare picture.
You've never had an action figure, did you? So I have something in you.
No, I don't. I don't have to deal with the action figure.
Well, that's kind of my story.
All right, that's a great story. I think you guys are, I haven't finished myself, but I'm on the stage. And tonight you're also going to talk about some other Disney legends and the connections that you had with each of them, correct?
Yeah, we may get weepy a little bit because these are the cream of the cream, and we could have picked others as well, but Tony, in the interest of time, Tony and I each picked five people we wanted to talk about.
That we really worked with, for me, these were people that became really close friends. And,
well, like Richard Irvine, right?
Yeah, that's the first picture of Dick. And the reason I wanted to talk about Dick was because he was actually the first person Walt hired to work on the parks. And he was an art director at 20th Century Fox and had come over to Victory Through Air Power. And Walt liked him a lot, so he became the design head of Imagineering.
Why did he pick a studio?
The studio designers, well, I'll tell you a story. When Walt first started talking about doing Disneyland, he went to his friend, Walt Beckett, the architect who designed the Walt Disney Music Hall and designed the Century Plaza Hotel, he said he wanted Mr. Beckett to help him, and Mr. Beckett said, well, what is it? And Walt had maybe for the first time described what he wanted to do at Disneyland, and when he was through, Mr. Beckett said, you know, you're going to use architects, but you're going to have to train your own people, because they'll understand what you're talking about. And it was the best advice he ever had, because look at, think of all the people he moved over from the studio, Mark Davis and Corey Coates, and John Hench and Herb Ryman, on and on and on, and so many great talents in the studio. So Dick, and here's a wonderful picture of Dick working with Mark Davis and Corey Coates and Atencio on the Pirates. And this is kind of an interesting picture because when we're planning the Small World boat and eventually the Pirates boat, there was a company called Arrow Development up in near San Francisco, and they had a test track. And here with is Walt in the front, Dick Irvine and Mark Davis, and Joe Fowler, who built Disneyland and Walt Disney World, and Herb Ryman, and they were the guinea pigs riding the first test. One of my favorite pictures, of course, this is when we cleared 100 acres to where the Magic Kingdom was going to be built in Florida, and that's Dick Irvine holding the master plan, and Walt Beckett, who did the design for the Contemporary Resort and the Polynesian Resort. And young Marty there standing on the yellow X, which is where the castle would be built. What was really interesting, John Hench dug a little hole there. We came back the next morning, the hole was full of water. We knew we had a little problem.
That's amazing. How about Harper Golf?
Well, Harper was just an amazing guy. He's a musician like you are, Billy and Banjo. But I think what everyone really remembers him for was really probably the first quintessential gay ride in Disneyland, which was the Jungle Cruise. And while he was doing that, he designed a lot of the Main Street buildings and also the Golden Horseshoe, the Review Theater. But for me, I was fascinated with something he'd done before that. And that was create the whole look of 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. And he, Walt wanted the Nautilus in that film to look like a cigar tube, an aluminum cigar tube. And Harper was horrified. So over a weekend, he built this Nautilus, brought it in on Monday, put it on his desk, but he had to make an appointment with Walt. And when he came back, the model was gone. So he went back up to Walt's office to tell him, I'm sorry, so he stole the model. And Walt, of course, was in there going, I have a new mania. Now, his mania was nothing compared to my mania with Harper's boat. So this is my house. And just show me another Nautilus, and I go crazy, and I have to have it. I did build the one in the middle, though. So
before he started as a model builder, right?
Yeah. I mean, like, they never sold these, like, back when I wanted it. So now that I'm older, I can buy them, but then I had to make it. So anyway, I knew Harper Goff as a genius before I knew him as a friend. He came back to Imagineering during the Epcot years, and just before he got started on Epcot, I was working on a thing called Discovery Bay. Has anybody heard about that? Okay. And Harper, who was this god, you know, he was like this amazing, he said, I'd love to work on that with you. And these are actually Harper Goff's designs for what would have been Discovery Bay. And I couldn't believe that. Every day I'd come into work and I felt like, how do I even approach this man? Who, to me, my whole life has been someone that, he did Willy Wonka. He did all of these other incredible things. And he was so excited to work on that. Now, he then got the assignment to work on World Showcase. And what you're about to see is the original World Showcase. And philosophically, it was a great idea. Everyone had the same frontage, and then depending on how much they had to say, they could go back further and further with the show. But it would have been really boring as a guest to go wander around that looking at the sameness. Harper believed we go to different countries because they're always unique. So behind his desk, he put this beautiful sketch. It was like a spider with a web behind it. You know, people would come in and say, Harper, what's that? He goes, oh, just a little thing I'm working on. And one day, some executives came in and they looked at it. And everyone was struggling. Marty was struggling to sell World Showcase and all that. This drawing behind Harper revolutionized the rest of that project. And Harper was given the lead role on it, and the rest is history. You've all been to World Showcase, and you can thank this man for what he did, as well as a great banjo player and a fabulous Nautilus designer.
I was worried about how you could put those countries next to each other, and they were worried that you couldn't put Japan next to Italy and this kind of thing, and that's what Harper's drawing did. It showed that those, he could do that with a front door that was, everybody got basically the same front door in a different way than that original model, and that Tony is absolutely right, that's what sold the project.
Maybe the real world will be inspired by those countries being next to each other, all getting along.
So. I'll tell you.
Yeah. And there was no sweeter couple than Harper and Scott Flossy. They were just
John Hench is the...
Well, John is amazing, you know. Here he is, he's the one with the board on his knee there next to Walt. And of course, he probably went on stage just a little away, but Walt was chewing out the engineer there. But John got his turn here. Let's see what the next one is. Here you are. It was his turn. This was about the new Tomorrowland that was being planned for '67. And John was the taste panel of Imagineering. I always like to quote what John said about the reassurance, what the parks meant from a reassurance standpoint. He always liked to say that the parks are reassuring to people because things work, things are clean, you can talk to a stranger in the parks, and you come away from going to Disneyland or Walt Disney World or Tokyo, all of them, and you say, why can't the outside world be like Disneyland, right?
I'm going to say that Disney told us that at least twice a month, walk through the entrance, don't go through the back, and, you know, experience what the guests, of course, they would have to pay, so it's easier than that, but, you know, the sort of experience, right?
But Walt really loved John. Here's an example of why he loved him. This is the original portrait of Mickey at 25, and all the artists at the studio, who did he pick out to do it? John Hench. And John, by the way, he was very interesting. He was a great friend of Salvador Dali's. And, you know, this design? Wow, this is John Hench, done in 1965, while Walt was still alive. And we couldn't do it at the time because there was no way of keeping those cars separated inside that dark space inside. At that time, computer technology wasn't sophisticated enough. And it wasn't until 1974, 75 that we finally were able to do this at Walt Disney World. And John designed Space Mountain for Walt Disney World, too.
Space Mountain, that's what you call mental real estate, right?
Mental real estate, Space Mountain, put them together, Disney owns it.
Big mental, is mental yes. real estate.
And here's some of the early concept drawings and plans for Epcot. That's Carl Walker and Ray Bradbury in the middle, who wrote the original story for our spaceship Earth, and John. And we had great times with Ray, and this is a true story. John Hench actually got Ray Bradbury to take the first airplane flight he ever took, because Ray was afraid to fly. But this man who wrote science fiction about Mars was afraid to fly. But John got him drunk at the opening of Epcot, and they flew back to Los Angeles together. Here's Marty and John, that early model for Epcot.
Wow.
John Hench worked 65 years at Imagineering. And he was still, he started in 1939 on Fantasia. And he was tough. Tony can tell you, he had some really tough moments, young people particularly, because John was so persnickety about design.
What do you mean about aesthetic? That was what I remember. When you used it flippantly, you know, he really pushed it.
If Walt Disney came back today, and I'm not saying, I was just in the other theater, did you guys go see in the bigger room? It's so cold in there, I think that's where they're keeping Walt. But if he, if he did come back, what would you guys show him? How about that?
I would show him that on my phone I've got every Disney movie. I don't think you can, and they're beautiful. They're absolutely beautiful.
I have to tell you a very short story, and that is that for years, I mean years, I was always asked, what would Walt think? And I refused to answer the question. Finally, when we opened Hong Kong Disneyland, they asked me the question in Cantonese, and I had a few minutes to think about it, and then they came back to me and they said, okay, what would Walt think in English? And I said, he would say, what took you so long?
Bob, okay. Bob was another person I was engaged with before I knew him. I was kind of a sneaky little kid who worked just scooping ice cream. Snuck down into the pirate ride, was peeking around the corner, and I heard this voice say, well, you can't see it very well from there. Why don't you jump down into the waterway and I'll give you a tour? For the next hour, I was engaged with this guy that would eventually be my mentor and friend. And he gave me this amazing thing. I got docked $2 an hour, you know, for not getting back to my ice cream window. It was the best hour I ever had. Now, Claude was a background guy. He did the backgrounds at the studio. And they're the unsung heroes, because if you've ever looked at these pictures in Pinocchio, those were painted by Claude Coates. And I think I was more in awe of that most of the animation. I just couldn't believe people could create these worlds that I wanted to be part of. And Walt sensed that, I think, in Claude, because in the next shot, you'll see a model built by Claude for Lady and the Tramp. And Claude realized that to get a dog's view, he needed a model so he could take photos of that model down at Lady's eye level so that he could then paint the background to look as it would, different from the dog's perspective. Walt, you know, always seeing every detail, realized, I'm moving that guy over where we use models all the time.
So Claude came over here, and again, another close deja vu. I worked there as a ride operator during the Summer of Love in 67.
All right.
Adventures of Inner Space.
Right.
And this was Disney's answer to the Ashbury, I think, at the time. It was a wild trip, and Claude was the genius who put all the things you saw in there together. And you can see Claude over on the far side there explaining it to the...
That was the makeup.
It was a makeup ride.
It
was a lot of things for a ride.
Yeah.
That, on to the next.
You told me it was a makeup ride.
There you go.
Yeah. Are we speaking from experience?
It's a dark ride.
It's a dark
ride. You have one of those cars, too.
I have one of those cars. Do you have one of those cars?
You had to use Old Spice when you went on your
ride. That's one for you. So, Claude's building this thing. It's a 20,000 leagues ride. You know what I think about 20,000 leagues? And I'm sitting there going, please, Mr. Coase, can I work on this? We suddenly realized we're the two people that met each other 5 years before in the pirate ride for the first time at Imagineering now. And so he says, okay, fine, I'm going to send you down to a state park in the field on a submarine ride in Florida. What they didn't tell me is it's 100% humid down there in the summer. So I'm out there gluing flowers and seashells on it. I'm working with a great Fred Scherter, who became someone who taught me most everything I know about working in the field and how to build a house. Claude was more than just, you know, someone I worked for. He was a mentor. And the days that we walked Disneyland, and he showed me all the things he'd done and how it all works and everything, I was just a sponge absorbing it on those trips. It was just something you couldn't learn in school. You know, that nobody teaches this. It was just an amazing thing. Mm-hmm. And I finally got the nerve to say, would you teach me how to paint a background like you did at the studio? And he said, it's a lot of work. Now, I said, yeah, sure, I'll do it. 6 weeks later, and I've never painted anything like this again, I finished this, and it hung over my desk, just like when Harper brought it. And somebody like you came around and said, well, what about that kid out in the model shop that has that Fantasyland thing? Maybe we let him redo the Fantasyland. And so, you know, advertising what you can do is a kind of a good thing.
Yeah.
It's like my cut head sheets, I guess, you guys use.
That is...
Now, I still see Alan quite once a year at least, and Abby, Claude's wife, for years after Claude passed. We're a family. I feel like they're second son. And
wonderful family.
Yeah, wonderful people. Yeah.
Tell us about, Marty, tell us about Blaine Gibson, who's audio animatronic.
He was really special because he was the sculptor shop, and he wanted to be an animator, and he was an animator. And, you know, he won an ivory soap carving contest when he was 12 years old in Colorado, and that's what started his artistic career. And Walt saw something that he did in the library, some little figures that Blaine had sculpted. And when Disneyland started, he said, Blaine, you're going to be my sculptor. And Blaine said, no, I'm an animator. And Walt said, you're now a sculptor. And he came over, and it took him a while, but he just loved it. And you know what? Just take a look at some of this work. These are the presidents without hair. And he had to do and supervise all of these presidents, and he studied every one of them. The one he hated doing, oh, did he hate doing it? Yes.
Trump?
Richard? Well, that would be today, Richard Nixon. He just hated
Why?
Doing it.
Okay.
I don't think I have to plan.
But he could take Mark Davis' drawings and have to sort of make them more real, like Walt wanted, right? Or like more human.
That was the issue, and I talked about this the other day, that I will show a couple more here, so we don't have to use up all our time, but this is Lincoln, who worked from a life mask, and here, next one is Will Rogers. Look at this. Isn't that amazing? Really unbelievable. And let's see what the last one is. Oh, this, This you know, right?
I have to tell you a story about this,
and I'll go back to that reality thing.
Okay.
When we were doing this, Blaine was living in Sedona, Arizona. He had retired, and he and John Hench were faxing in those days back and forth how they wanted Walt's five-finger hand to go into Mickey's four-finger hand. And then for the final dialogue on this, we went to Sedona, and I'm telling you, I sat there while these two gentlemen would talk for a full hour and manipulated how those hands were going together. It was that moment, because look at that, that's Walt and Mickey holding hands, and that was the key moment in this whole sculpture, and that's how deep they went into it. But, you know, Blaine had the big issue that here was Mark's wonderful sketches, for example, of the pirates, all the humor, and they were cartoonish, but Walt wanted reality. He wanted those figures to be real. And I told this story about Blaine one night when we were building the Walt Disney World. We went to dinner and we lost him. He was off somewhere. And I finally said, Blaine, what's going on? He said, well, the chef came out of the kitchen and his hand's too big for his body. I said, I'm going to remember that and I'm going to use it sometime. And I said, is this a usual thing for you at meals? And he said, yes. My wife, Coral, developed a technique. It was called kick me under the table because he's staring at all these people. I kept digging deeper and deeper. And I said, were some of the pirates based on reality? And he said, yes. And I said, reality? And he spent a long time in church. Any of the people you went to church with turned out as creatures in the pirates? And he looked at me and he didn't want to answer. He finally said, yes. I didn't pursue it really.
And you, Tony, you had something to do with that statue too, right?
I did. You know, we were trying to find the best place because it was a beautiful piece. But at the same time, Disney was doing promotions where they had a car giveaway there. So and they had a ball that had motorcycle.
Oh, that was awful.
There, like this, no one was going to ever touch that ground again.
And
that
was
that is proof true.
Now, I know you were close to Bill Evans too.
Bill, I knew again before I worked in Imagineering. I was going to Cal Poly and Pomona. Some college folks.
My father went there and said the same thing.
Yeah.
Cool.
And so Bill, on Monday and Tuesday when Disneyland was closed in the olden days, Bill would take his time and bring us out to the jungle and take us out on the ride. And he would stop the boat. And he would point out each tree, and he had stories. Like, I remember one, he had a particular tree he loved in Beverly Hills, was out in the front yard, and the husband was fond of that tree in his house, too. So he waited until the guy went to work, went up and knocked on the door, and showed the wife this beautiful tree in his truck that they would put in the front yard, and he would get rid of this big old ugly tree that they had for free. So by that night, they had a new front tree, and Bill had what he called one of his stars in the jungle cruise. And all along that day, we spent an hour of that day out on this boat ride, and every tree was pointed out, and everyone had a story. It was like friends. He knew them as friends. It was really
speaking
awesome.
Of stealing plants, you took quite a few out of Disney Park. What's in your front yard? Tell me.
So, for the fireworks show on the 60th anniversary, they decided that they wanted more people to see it. And the beautiful olive trees had grown, so I took three of Bill's trees. And I think he'd be really happy if he's still alive today and the twinkle lights still come on. But, the amazing thing about watching Bill work, in Paris, we have a problem that it snows in the winter, you know, so it's cold. And we have Adventureland. How do you do the lush, rich, like Hawaii or South America, whatever, where you've got 2 feet of snow on the ground? Well, he found the rhododendrons, and he found, these are bushes. He found tree-sized rhododendrons in Germany that had beautiful purple flowers. And he convinced this gardener opportunity to sell all of those road cut pieces in Paris. And we planted them, and you're looking right here at a collection of how that looks every spring. It's gorgeous. And in the winter, rhododendrons are the only large leaf plant that doesn't lose its leaves. So it looks good all year round. And that was the kind of detail guy he was.
And he knew everybody in the world, and he and they knew him. And so if he wanted something particular, he could call almost anybody, and they'd say, here's where you can find it.
And it was before the internet, so to make that point, Marty, we were over in Holland, and if you haven't been there, the Keukenhof Garden is open 6 weeks a year, they do like 4 months.
You got to do it. It's a great one.
Unbelievable. So we were all set. Like Bill said, it's the best garden in all of Europe. So we arrived on Monday morning to find out Sunday was the last day. Banging on the gate, you know, and finally a caretaker comes down. I pull out the WBI card, web card, I guess. And I said, we're from America, we came from here, and they go, so what? And I said, but Bill Evans. And when I said that word, the guy goes, Bill Evans, the horticulturist? And I said, yes. Runs into the admin building, and out come 8 suits, unlock the gate, and we're given this amazing tour of that garden, and 5 resumes to work at Disneyland Paris. To your point, is he was that well regarded around the world for what he did, and so respected that that was the kind of thing that you'd find.
All right, let's talk about the people that were the real Imagineers, the women. Okay.
The
women of Imagineers. You don't hear enough about, but I know the first major Imagineering. You were friends with Red Harriet Burns, Marty.
Oh, Harriet was very special. And of course, Walt loved her, and saying that Harriet, she'd come to work every day so immaculately dressed. It was, I mean, just like she was going to go out to dinner at the fanciest restaurant, not in this costume. But this was at the studio, 1955, I guess, when they were doing storybook land for the first time. But the point is, Harriet could do anything any of the guys could do. Look at this.
She would roll up her sleeves and immerse them in resin.
And this is Fred, and I think that's Claude.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, with Harriet and working on I think it's the Matterhorn. They would do all of these, and Harriet, of course, worked very closely with Harper Gotham on all the World Showcase shows and the facades and things. And if you go back through the television shows, Walt's lead-ins, and invariably, if it involved Imagineering, Harriet was in the picture. Because she was a Texan, and Walt would come over, and he'd pull up a chair and sit down and talk to Harriet for a half an hour. I'm telling you, he really liked her.
You said that Walt said that Harriet could sling it like the rest of them.
Yeah, she could sling it like all guys, and including language.
Yeah. I know that because she was my next door neighbor at the model shop, separated by a bird joker. But so every day we would catch up on what had happened in the last 24 hours. And she knew everything in Imagineering because every executive came there at least once a day. Talk with Harriet. And this is a shot when we reopened the Disney Gallery with a model, the original model that Harriet and Fred had built for the opening of Disneyland.
You know, I guess we shouldn't talk about this, but no, but and toward the end of their lives, Blaine Gibson and Harriet ended up in the same, not a rest home, but it was assisted living place, and they became sweethearts because both Harriet's husband had died years before, and Coral Blaine's wife had passed away, and it was so sweet to see the two of them together and talking about all their friends that they missed, and it was really wonderful up in the Montecito area.
Who were some of the other women?
Well, yeah. Mom shot that. So this is Wathel Rogers, of course, and you remember way back when there was what is that right?
Oh, it's Nature's Wonderland.
Nature's Fighting Man, yeah. And these are the elks that were fighting in Wathel was demonstrated in for war. And let's see who else.
Fred, yeah, it's Fred.
Here's Fred Jerger on the left. Tony talked about him. He was the first person really of going out in the field. And was the greatest moment, one of the great moments of my life when I talked Fred into coming out of retirement to work on Epcot, because we needed somebody who really knew what to do.
I know he had his 65th birthday when we built Big Thunder, and he was really going to stick it through and say, I'm going to stay with this one.
And he could do anything. And as Tony said, he built his own house.
Yeah.
And probably
taught me how to do my own house.
Yeah. Very wonderful. And, of course, Leota Toombs Thomas. And she worked at the model shop with Harriet Burns. This is Kim Irvine's mother. And Joyce Carlson and Harriet Burns and Leota, they're all Disney legends.
And if you've heard Hurry Man, that's what Leota's voice is in her face.
Randy Bright.
Randy. Randy lives here in Orange County, so he was another one of us that grew up down here, and we would carpool to work. He also had that 5 years of learning here at Disney. He's a ride operator. Built like a football player, but I think he had the most emotionally sensitive heart that I've ever known. And he came up with a show that really intrigued me. We called it Good Show, Bad Show. And without him, Gary Kruger did the filming of this, because Gary was so inspired by Randy's concept that he went out and photographed. On the right side of the screen were shots of the real world, and on the left side of the screen were shots of Disneyland. And you could pull in and out on those, and you'd see how in the real world things go to pot, and no matter how far back you get in Disneyland or how close up, there's always something wonderful to see. And it was so dramatic and saying something that it's hard to put into words, but it's what Disney, like why Disneyland is so great. So that was one side of him that I really admired. And he was always there with a crazy new idea. And this one, he said, let's put a real guy in the Haunted Mansion and have him jump out at you. And, well, it was a great idea, but some people were frightened to death by it. So.
It was great to have all those lawsuits of people that had heart attacks.
I remember one day we were watching the 3D movie Imagine Journeys, and he said to me, imagine having a concert with Michael Jackson. And you could have it every day by filming it in 3D in real scale, and it would just run in 3D, and we kind of ended up doing that years and years later. But he had that kind of a mind.
And he wrote the American Story.
Well, yeah.
American Adventure, right.
So go to the next one, and we'll have... Okay, so, yeah, simulator, right. We had been looking for a way to tell the Star Wars story. You know, how are we going to do that? It's a galaxy of songs. And Randy said, I was over in England, and they have this really interesting thing that trained fighter pilots and airline pilots. I got to go over and look at it. So we did, and of course it was perfect for putting people in the first time ever, you know, simulation with human beings other than pilots. And I always wanted to do that. That was the line we gave Rex, and he guided us on this out-of-control journey. And I don't think that would have happened if Randy had, you know, picked that up in his mind and said, go look at it. Another one, I was so frustrated. Your favorite, my favorite, Bill Finkman. We had tried hundreds, actors, actresses, everyone. And I was saying, Randy, I don't know what I'm going to do. We look at it and we listen to the voice. It doesn't work. He goes, well, it's such a little guy. Maybe it would be a little person that would do the voice. And that cracked it. We brought in Billy Barney, and it was perfect. When you looked at it, you just said, that's the voice. And it became kind of a late life career for Billy to do Finkman for us forevermore. So that was, again, the kind of thing he was. And for me, one of the best things he did for me, I was finishing up Splash Mountain, and he said, what do you think about going over to Europe? Would you be interested in that? And I go, okay. What do you think about going over to Europe and spending 3 years over there? I think that's a pretty good, exciting job. So Randy kind of set the stage for me to get to meet the Aftermath of the Disneyland Paris project. So once again, it turned into something I feel is the most beautiful part we've done. And again, I wouldn't have had an opportunity if it wasn't for this
our carpool drives every day to work. But the thing, Randy, I think will be remembered forevermore, everyone had taken a stab at doing the American Adventure Show, compressing all of America into a 30-minute show with musical numbers in it. That's a pretty awesome task. And he and his partner, Bob Morley, wrote this song that I think is really the legacy. We lost Randy way, way too early in an accident, but every time I go to the show, he's still with us. We're going to give you just a bit of that song.
Is it?
America, spread your golden wings, sail on freedom's wind across the sky. Great bird, with your golden dreams, flying high.
Co-writer on that. His name is Bob Holley, and we found Bob singing in a bar in Newport Beach. And he wrote this song, and he wrote a song for the Canadian Pavilion. And Listen to the Land for episode.
Yeah.
It was really something. So I'd go back to that bar any day.
Randy had a party in his backyard with Bob Holley, singing all the Epcot songs way before the park, and said, "I'm going to give you a preview." It sparked so much energy in all of us that night.
How about Herb Ryman, Marty?
Well, you know, who did he pick out to do the first drawing of Disneyland? This is Herbie. With some illustrations for the Ford attraction we did for the New York World's Fair, but the really beautiful thing was this. Over a weekend in 1953, and this is all in pencil. And if you ever get the chance to see this, just spend a little time just walking through it, basically, because there's so much detail in it. There's things in this that were at Walt's head that were not done in Disneyland until year five or year six. It was amazing, but it was done over a weekend on a Saturday and Sunday. And I'll bet you there's nobody else in the world who could have done this but Herb Ryman. It was really amazing.
They just sold it?
They sold the phony one of that.
You think? Yeah. Got ripped off.
Yeah, there were some brown, what we call brown lines, that were made for each of the art directors to have in the field while Disneyland was being built. And they put a color wash on it. They also made a smaller one for Roy to take to New York to show the bankers. But the one that was sold recently was, I just heard the story the other day, it was Gabe Scagnamello, who was the architect. The art director on Tomorrowland in Disneyland, and one of the people who worked with him when they finished building Tomorrowland said, "Can I have that map?" And Gabe said, "Sure, I don't want her. Besides, I'm leaving the company." You know, and he and several others did leave. That was the map that got sold, not the original, which is still on the wall at Imagineering. So but look at this. This is the black and white pencil drawing of the castle for Walt Disney World. That's about a foot tall, I'm sorry, yeah, about 12 inches tall. And then he followed up drawing. The original was done as an illustration so the architects could start designing the castle. Then he did this beautiful one that we could use for marketing purposes. And here's Tokyo Disneyland, the very first drawing that we used to sell the Oriental Land Company on doing the park. And you know this one, this is the entrance to Epcot. We wanted to say it was international, it was transportation, it was a new century, etc. Wow, this is just a wonderful piece. By the way, Herbie, like some of the other artists, loved to put people in it. And Randy Bright is down here in the corner. And that brown suit, brown jacket, that's Randy.
Can we talk about a guy that Tony and I had the pleasure of seeing on this stage last night, Richard Robert Sherman. I know Richard is here. Taping TVs. I had to sneak a tape recorder in the park because it wasn't legal to do that then. And I put it in a Disneyland bag and I got it all out and I taped the TV. And I didn't know these guys then, but I knew the worlds they created and the souvenirs that I could take home. You could take that home sort of legally. They sold records. It's a small world. Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow. And of course, And I worked on. For all summer, that summer of love, I worked on Adventure Through Inner Space, where we had miracles from molecules are happening every day. Okay, so that was the formative part of my life, as well as the films Mary Poppins. So when Marty said, bring in whoever you want, we've got such a big task here, you know, we've got to get all the people together to do great things. And I immediately thought of these people that captured stories with music. Because in a ride, it's really hard to pick out dialogue and all that, but you can go home with a song. And so when we're doing Imagination, it was one of the most abstract concepts for Epcot. We thought, what better way to make a very complicated story simple? And that's one of their three S's, I think, Richard. Simplicity. To make this show simple. And they came up with one little spark. Which became a classic, and then they didn't end there. They wrote Magic Journeys and Making Memories, and it was a home run hit. It was just
amazing. I think the first time I went on Small World, I was about five, and the song's still in my head. I can't get it. That's the magic.
I always say, tell people that if we can get the whole world to do what Bob and Dick wrote in that song, there's just one moon and one golden sun, and a smile means friendship to everyone. Wouldn't it be a great world?
We had a fairly small budget when we were developing Tomorrowland. That's an era we won't go into. But and I said, please, please come help us. And they did, and they recrafted Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow into. There's a bright new world of convention, so we had Tom Rose and they helped us again with another show there, and it was wonderful to have that encore with you guys. Just an amazing experience. And I was glad to be there, Richard, when you got the window for the pair of you at Disneyland. It was an amazing moment. I mean, you deserve it.
Complex attraction, ride systems, the audio animatronic figures to life. On Friday, Bob Iger honored Wayne Jackson, Disney Legend Award. And Wayne represents producers like Roger Groby and Bob Booth and Bill Gallagher, who helped create and install this complex technology for Disney theme parks. We have him here today. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Wayne Jackson.
Neil Gallagher was one of the people that had great inspiration to me. And when we first started working at Mabel and developing the audio animatronic figures, I'll never forget Neil and I had met and Dave Swinger, some of the other technicians. We'd been working on that, and we thought we had it just about perfect.
Yeah.
And I remember Roger Brody, who was vice president there at the time, walks down, he looks up at it, he says, it's going to leak. It was a hydraulic figure.
What?
And he just walked by, says, it's going to leak. We said, no, it won't leak, Roger. We all went to lunch. We come back. There was hydraulic oil all over. So it was Bob Booth and I, we worked together for so many years in the mechanical development. Bob had the rights. And I was doing the animation and the plastics. One of the people I worked a lot with in the development of the vehicles, the models, was the one of the legend, Bob Kerr. And Bob would come down and we'd sculpt up the, or the technician, he would sculpt up the model. And then Bob would come down and we'd, you know, and he'd make the changes, and it kept getting better and better always. Space Mountain vehicles, all of the different rides. Haunted Mansion vehicle, I remember that one very closely.
Luma.
Yeah. And another person that was kind of my mentor was Martin Davis. When we were doing the one of the first projects I had was Jungle Cruise for Walt Disney World after we finished Haunted Mansion and the Pirates of the Caribbean for Disneyland. And so Mark, I was working with Mark, he showed me the sketches and he'd say, well, this is what we want to do. And he says, come on, let's go over to the zoo and study the animals. And he taught me the anatomy, how to read the anatomy of the various animals when we were doing the Jungle Cruise. And it was very interesting. And then as far as that, then the human anatomy, Blaine Gibson taught me a very great amount about that. Worked with Blaine many, many years. And the facial movements when we were developing the figures, getting the smiles, getting the pinches, getting the height correct. Blaine was always a very methodical about the eyes. And that was one thing that makes the person.
Yeah.
You know, I worked with Blaine and Wayne had to carry it out. You only have a few seconds to say something about a character when you're riding past it in a ride through. And that was a really trick, really important trick Blaine did. Guys
have it. Yes.
And the fact that people don't understand that they have to run all day from 8 in the morning until midnight and then turn on and get an 8 hours, that blows me away.
That was one of our biggest challenges, was getting, when we first started building the audio animatronics, Pirate Auctioneer was basically our first figure, was finding there was no robots at that time.
Yeah, right.
And for the little facial movements and the figures, yeah, we had to develop the little small actuators and that type of thing, and all of the parts.
It's still there today.
And they're still running today.
Incredible. Hey, we have another honor for you, and the new president of Walt Disney Imagineering is here to give it to you. Please welcome Bob Weiss to the stage.
Thank you, John, for letting me barge in for a minute.
No problem.
But, you know, I want to add my thought to the way to think about Dwayne is all these great things that you hear about our artists and our designers that we all dream up all the time, and all those things you see over and over, you wouldn't have seen them without Dwayne. The other amazing thing, I think, is that you didn't have CAD, you didn't have 3D printing. Hell, you didn't even have Xerox machines.
No.
That's what that was about. So, myself and a number of us first met Wayne and a lot of his peers in the early 80s when we all went over to work in Tokyo together. And they were the senior guys who knew how to do all this stuff. We were kids who didn't know anything, but you mentored us, taught us a lot. And actually, Wayne got into a track, and so much of Tokyo, first gate, second gate, all through that history, is so associated with you, Wayne, and all the great things, partnership with OLC, and that has just been an amazing history for the company and for Wayne. So your colleagues, both Imagineering, to congratulate you, as well as Marina Lane and Company, sent you a little something. Okay. I wanted to deliver personally on everyone's behalf. First off, a flourish sheet. Here you go.
Oh, wow.
Oh, my. Son, congratulations on becoming a Disney legend. Your Tokyo Disney Resort friends at Walt Disney Imagineering and OLC. Congratulations.
Attend that session in person. Marty, thank you for everything, and I think Jim Cora, former Disneyland International Chairman, said it best of Marty. Marty understands the Disney way because he learned it at Walt's knees. He is the keeper of the keys, the conscience, the Jiminy Cricket for the organization. Thanks, Marty, and thank you for watching and listening to Sam's Disney Diary. Make sure you subscribe. We'll see you next time. Congalush.
You never know just what we'll see.